Okay, so we're now on to our final speaker, and it's Emily Oberman. Emily is partner and designer at Pentagram. She is a multidisciplinary designer and strategist, working in everything including motion graphics, publications, packaging, advertising, and websites. Her recent projects include strategy and branding for DC Entertainment and the LA Film Festival, as well as opening sequences for Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt. She gave up acting to pursue a career in graphic design, apparently. So will you please give a final warm welcome to the stage, Emily Oberman.
Hi. Wait, I'm timing myself. Hi, everybody. Wait, there's no clicker. It was my job to bring it up. Okay. Hello. I'm Emily Oberman. And my talk today is called Entertaining Design, because I believe that design for the entertainment industry should be entertaining and we should all think about it. It is also called It's Nice to Be Nice to the Nice, because truthfully, I don't want to work with assholes anymore. The nicer you are to me, the more you'll get out of me. It just works that way. I once literally had a client scream in my face, "If you ever say no to me again, I'm gonna go to your house and kill your children." He is not my client anymore, and my children are fine. It's also called because, not just because I love The Wizard of Oz, but also because it's funny how in your life, one thing leads to another that leads to another that leads to another, and sort of you end up somewhere, hopefully, where you want to be. And that's currently my situation, though who knows what tomorrow will bring. The other thing that I wanted to say before I start is the talks today and yesterday have been fantastic. FITC, you've done an amazing job. I've loved every single one that I've gone to. Brilliant. And a lot of people talk about finding their passion and going and like leaving their job to find their passion and all of this stuff about finding who you are. And I started to like have like a level of self-loathing, because I'm gonna show a lot of work that I've done and it's not about finding my passion. And then I realized this is my passion. Like, this is what I do. It's what I live for. I was being interviewed once at another conference, and the woman said to me, "So what do you do to express yourself outside of work?" And I said, "I don't know, nothing." And she like closed her laptop. It was like, "Thank you." And I thought, it's a lot. So also, the work that I'm showing is great. It's done by me and a team. But the other thing to think about is it's all done with the leadership of a woman. I don't think of myself as a female designer. I think of myself as a designer. But the truth of the matter is it's harder. It's harder for us. Someone said to me recently, if feminism worked, we wouldn't need feminism anymore. So that's one of the reasons that I point this out. So it's also a lot about luck and about being in the right place at the right time. So you can do great work and you can have great clients, but there's luck involved. It's like backgammon. Backgammon is a perfect blend of skill and luck. And that's kind of what design is. So the luck begins with Cooper Union, which is an art school in the East Village. It's fantastic, and my parents met there. So they both went there and they met there, and so that's sort of the beginning of my luck, because without Cooper Union, I wouldn't be here. My parents, super badasses, like awesome. This is them at their judo club, both black belts, and both graphic designers and artists. And when I was growing up, they taught me to love art and design and music. And these are the kind of things that they were obsessed with that I then became obsessed with and remain obsessed with. And the last thing I want to point out is this is the national flag of Anguilla, which is an island in the Caribbean, and my parents designed it. So since I was little, like, Anguilla seceded from the British colonies, and we used to spend a lot of time in Anguilla. We had Anguillan friends who were in the government, and they were like, we need a flag. You guys are designers, so my parents are in flag books and the history, and it's awesome. I'm very proud of them. Anyway, so because of Cooper Union and my parents, there was me. And here's me while I was at Cooper Union in my bright red kitchen. Why, I don't know. And here's one of the other reasons that I wanted to go to Cooper Union was because of people like Herb Lubalin or Max Fleischer, who invented Betty Boop, or Alex Katz, or Seymour Quast, or Milton Glaser, or Herb Lubalin, and also, oh, and Bob Kane, who invented Batman, for any of you who were at the talk earlier. And it was free. Like, in New York or in the United States, that's a big deal. But the college was free. And always free for anyone, always welcoming. Anyway, after graduating Cooper Union, I had the good fortune to work at a design studio called M & Company. Is anyone familiar with M & Company? No, two people. M & Company was a design studio run by a man named Tibor Kalman. He was a crazy person, smart, funny, awesome, my mentor other than my parents. This is some of the work that I did when I was at M & Company. Things like books for Herb Ritz or Colors magazine, Interview magazine, that umbrella that's at the MoMA still. Anyway, it was a great time and it taught me to think. It taught me to think differently and to sort of challenge things and always worry and always think about the words, not just the design. Anyway, after M & Company, I started my own design studio with my then best friend, not that we're not friends anymore. Her name is Bonnie Siegler, and we started our own company, two women owned, which is great because you get all sorts of tax breaks for that also. And this is some of the work that we did at number 17 during the years. We got a chance to redesign Colors, which was nice because I got to clean up the logo in a way that had been driving me crazy for years. And at number 17, we started working on Saturday Night Live. It was kind of a coincidence, not a coincidence, a man who had met me at M & Company, hated Tibor, left, didn't hire us, and then years later found me and asked us to start doing the titles for Saturday Night Live. And in terms of finding your passion, I have to say, I should be like, have bigger ideals, but like when I was a kid, my parents let me watch the first episode of Saturday Night Live and I fell in love. And I've loved the show ever since. It's always been something that I really was drawn to. And so when I got the chance to work on it, I was thrilled, more than thrilled. So here, this is what Saturday Night Live's titles looked like before we started working on them. It was kind of like scrappy comedy club style. And we decided that they were not a scrappy comedy club anymore. They were like the big grandpa of comedy. So we changed their logo and sort of brought it into a clean, like, Blue Note jazz thing. And the only thing that we did to make it a logo is everyone says Saturday Night Live. So we thought, not a bad idea to just take out the word spacing, and that became the logo. And we then began to do titles for the show, and we did them for 12 years. These are stills of that. 12 years of titles, like every 4 years, you redo them. And then one day, Lorne Michaels decided it was time to change the logo. Lorne Michaels, a Canadian? whatever he says goes. And he said it's time to change the logo, so we said okay. And we presented this logo because we liked it, because it was like an onomatopoeia. He says, Saturday Night Live. So we thought, oh, that's great. Saturday Night Live gets bigger, wider, terrific. So we presented it. I should look over here. Lauren said, it's great. I love it. They put it on the show. And then between commercials, they have these things called bumpers where they take the celebrity hosts, if you're not familiar, and photograph them with the logo doing cute things. So this is the season premiere of that year. That's Dane Cook. And it aired, and it was great. And Sunday morning, I got a call, and Lorne Michaels doesn't like the logo. He doesn't think it's right yet. And I was like, ah, well. you know, what are you going to do? And they were like, no, you're going to redo the logo. And so we were like, what? So the other thing I have to say is Saturday Night Live, the titles of the show all get made. The titles get made in 2 weeks. The show gets made in 1 week, obviously. And so we went away and we were like, shit, a week. Okay, it can't be that different, but it's going to be a little different. So we decided Saturday Night Live, like still onomatopoeia, still okay. Presented it, Lauren loved it. Here it is on a Jamie Presley bumper. Sunday morning, nope, Lauren still thinks it needs a little work. So this time I knew not to say like, oh, what are you gonna do? So we did, like we tweaked it just a little and we did that. And still onomatopoeia, Saturday Night Live still works. And then they went back and they re-edited and redid every single bumper for the previous 3 weeks and every single shot and every title frame to have the old logos don't exist in the world at all. Except I found that the Jamie Presley and the Dane Cook thing on the photographer Mary Ellen Matthews website. Anyway, here are some title sequences, the beginning of title sequences that we did with this logo over another 10 years. So the cool thing about working on Saturday Night Live is it's the same brief every year. Same brief, New York City, nighttime, cast, party you wish you were at, logo. Like, and so we've been doing it for 22 years. So what's cool about it is sort of stretching that muscle every 3 or 4 years and like thinking about how can this be different? It's, you know, some people might not notice, everyone notices the year it changes, but then everyone forgets that it's ever been different. Anyway, after Saturday Night Live, or during that whole period, I met Paul Sayer, fantastic graphic designer, better than, it makes me crazy how good he is, and we got married. lucky me. And then there he is, charming. And then we had two children, Eli and Harry. I always swore that I would not be one of those people who like, oh, this is my greatest project ever, people. I'm not saying that. What I am saying, here they are, adorable. That photo, I don't know if you guys know this movie, but I call it Harold and Eli Escape from Guantanamo Bay. Anyway, what I am bringing it up for is because besides being a woman, being a mother of twins and shortly thereafter becoming a partner at Pentagram and still trying to keep your career is fucking hard. And I just, like, I'll talk a little bit about balancing those things during this, but just, they are adorable, but it's really hard. I'm sure a lot of people have children and you understand. Anyway, after that, we decided we had number 17 for 17 years. Not always in the plan, but kind of worked out great. And at that time, I was asked to join Pentagram. It's a rigorous process. You have to meet everyone. You get interviewed. And Paul was like, no, don't. You're going to kill yourself. But I don't know. I always really loved Pentagram, really admired it. And like, well, my heroes work there. And, you know, it's kind of like being asked to be in the Yankees. Like, the Yankees are a big baseball team. and so I said yes, and I am thrilled. We are 23 partners in three countries, 23 partners in four offices. And the other thing I wanted to point out is someone at Pentagram was like, oh, we're so diverse now. And I'm like, no, we're not. We're mostly white guys. And in the 44 years that Pentagram has existed, and I love Pentagram, it's great, and everyone is so creative, and it's like a socialistic system. Everyone helps each other, and people work on their own or team up, but In the 44 years the Pentagram has existed, there have been 60 partners total. 8 of them have been women, and 4 of those women are in the past 7 years. So that's half in the past 7 years. So we're getting there. Also, 1 African-American and 1 Asian person so far. We're working on it. But anyway, Pentagram is a wonderful place to work. This is some of the work that made me want to join Pentagram, some of the work done by people that I have admired forever, and it's great work. And the thing about Pentagram is it's not this like giant behemoth. It's actually, there's sort of an umbrella, and then there are like silos that are each partner, and you work like a boutique design firm. You work like a small, nimble team. All right, 30 minutes left. Okay, so it's actually much more human than you might think. So at Pentagram, we went back and we did Saturday Night Live. Again, it was totally new because it was at Pentagram. And so Lauren said, time to change the logo. It was the 40th anniversary. And so we changed the logo. Don Pardo, the guy who had said Saturday Night Live, had died. So we thought we could do a logo that didn't have to be an onomatopoeia, but sort of reflected more of the lights and the action of the city. So we did that logo for the 40th anniversary, and then the titles for the 40th anniversary were super fancy and super glam and had like a helicopter that flew all over the city, and I was very fond of them. It's like your children, like you're fond of each of the the opens. These are the bumpers. And what was nice is the logo was identifiable even if you took it apart entirely. But then last year, was time to do the open again. And so we, Mary Ellen Matthews, the photographer, and I decided that we wanted to do something that was black and white, which hadn't been done in a really long time, and reflected both French New Wave and New York New Wave, like so 60s and 80s. And so we wanted to do something that brought all of that together and felt a little bit more beautiful and a little bit more elevated, and kind of also had a hand-drawn part of it. So we looked at a lot of Godard, and we looked at a lot of Truffaut, and then we cut a test of the open, and it looked like this.
It's Saturday Night Live!
So this is all with Godard footage or Truffaut footage. And this is a test that we did on, like,
Bryant.
Monday.
Michael Che. Pete Davidson.
We started shooting the cast on Tuesday through Thursday and finished the open on Saturday. Lorne Michaels doesn't see it till the night of the dress rehearsal, which is also, he trusts his team. He just trusts everyone, and it goes, not always great, but usually there's like a zenness about it. And this is the new open.
Saturday Night Live with Beck Bennett, Amy Bryant, Michael Che, Pete Davidson.
And these are bumpers that we do, and they all have little hand animations in them now, and that's this year. We shot in really glamorous places. I was inside the Metropolitan Museum with Kate McKinnon at 2:00 in the morning, because you don't start shooting till like 10 p.m. And the cool thing about it was not Kate McKinnon, it was just being in the Metropolitan Museum at 2:00 in the morning with nobody else there. Anyway, because of Saturday Night Live and because I was at Pentagram, I met Snoop Dogg's manager. And he and I hit it off really well. They asked us to design the packaging for Snoop's new line of cannabis products. So I got to go to a grow with Snoop, and like, I'd never seen that much cannabis in my life. Snoop had. But anyway, so it was great, and we went together, and he's really great and smart and charming, and so he said, this is what our brief was. He was like, oh, I like diamonds, I like pot, I like California sun. You guys just dibble and dabble a little bit and see what you come up with that reflects me. And I was like, all right, we'll dibble and dabble. But they also wanted it to feel not like a regular cannabis product, not hempy, not Rasta-y, but more like something that a grandma would want and a teenager, not a teenager, and a college kid would want. So we made an abstracted golden leaf. And then we put it on products that made it feel like a box that you would want to keep on your shelf. You wouldn't be, you wouldn't need to hide it. I mean, every box when you opened it had a photograph of a California thing with golden rays through it. And we asked Snoop to write some taglines for it, and he did. Those are stickers inside the box. These are the chocolates. And then Leafs by Snoop comes down, comes down to LBS, which is pounds, which is a pound, and they decided to do smoking accessories, so this is the identity we did for Snoop's line of bongs. There was a moment, we were also working for We were also working for like a female empowerment company at the time, and it was empowerment through sex toys. And there was a moment where a package came to my office, and I thought before I opened it, I was like, I literally don't know if this is a box of bongs or a box of sex toys. Like, what a good job. Anyway, so this is the stuff. We worked on the copy with them. We worked on their mission statement. Snoop named those, but then we did little icons of all the different ships. He also named all the actual lines of cannabis. Anyway, because of Leafs by Snoop and because of M & Company, I met a woman named Audrey Gelman. She had this idea for a new social club for women only that was like going to be empowering for women, and it was just going to be us, and it was going to be great, and it was going to be a place because women, everybody knows, you've had to change your shoes or do your hair in like the bathroom at Starbucks. There's not really a place that's just comfortable. And so this was going to be a place where women could do that and check their email or whatever. And it was going to be called Refresh. And Refresh was kind of a terrible name. It sounded a little douchey. And so Audrey went away to think about this, but we would have meetings talking about what the brand would be, and it was also when Hillary and Trump were running for president, and every week we would talk more about politics, and we talked about it and fretted over it and talked and talked, and then as we got closer to the election, we suddenly realized that it might not go our way, because the wing was going to be this this utopian world where like all the women were happy because they had the first female president. So at the time, she renamed it The Wing, kind of like a helper, kind of like, uplifting, but also like the West Wing. And when Hillary did not win, also Bernie Sanders has announced that he's running for president again, if anyone cares. Today. Anyway, it became a different kind of place. It became a place of activism. It became a safe space for women. There was Me Too happening. It became this like haven that got people to the march, to the women's march, that did things, that taught people there to have a voice, and also was a safe space for both women who were being harassed, but also women, with hijabs. They could go there and take off their hijab because there were no men there. So that's sort of so we were inspired by the design of protests, but we're also inspired by language and funny things. And just because you're doing things that are about protest doesn't mean you're not doing things that are cool or beautiful or super funny. So we made a board of a bunch of women that we thought would be members of the wing. And then we gave them each a W for wing or women or whatever. And that became the identity for the wing. And we picked this W as the hero W because it's strong, but curvy and weird. And then, as proof of concept in our presentations, we started showing like swag. Just like, oh, this would be funny, let's do a shower cap, let's do a thing that says bag lady, ha ha ha, and they were like, these are great, we're gonna sell them in our store. So that's how we started doing all the swag for the wing. And it was by accident. It was just because we were enjoying working with them. It was a whole female team on our side, and we were just collaborating with the client. So after that, we also did all their social media for a year, their website, because they had nothing. They were like a tiny, tiny organization. They are now expanding by gajillions. There's one coming to Toronto. They're going global. It's huge. It was the right moment. It was like a dog whistle for women. And here are the spaces. They're incredibly beautiful. We work with them on the design and the identity within the design. We also, they have phone booths. So we also did these phone booths where we took women of fiction and gave them, like, you know, signs like an old detective. So, you know, Ramona Quimby, it just says the pest. If anyone knows the book Ramona the Pest. Anyway. The other cool thing was Hillary spoke at the wing. They have all these people speaking at the wing. And so it was sort of this full circle thing for us. Like, she was sort of supposed to be the thing that empowered us. And then there she was speaking. Anyway, because of the wing, also women-owned company, I've started to realize that that's a focus for us, is working with women-owned companies. We met these two women who had this crazy idea to make a, like, hip, cool pots and pans company. And we really, really liked them. Oh, nope, I forgot. Sorry. No man's land, I'll go through this really fast. The Wing is actually making a magazine now, and the magazine's tagline is for women with something to say and nothing to prove. And so we worked with them on the design. We did shitloads of logos and covers because it was fun, and then this is the identity they picked. And this is what the first cover was. That's Hari Neff. And this is what the magazine had, a really strong grid, and then we took that grid and we threw it out and we tried to do something like as different or appropriate for each story as we could. There's always a centerfold. This is Maxine Waters, the woman who said, "Reclaiming My Time," if anyone is unfamiliar. This is the second issue. That's Jessica Williams on the cover. We also write the copy, like Hot Mess was all about, like, it's the fashion article that's all about, like, clothes that are slightly fucked up, like she's all super sweaty. And again, like, we tried to do fun, kooky things with the typography and sort of break the rules. Lisa Simpson was our centerfold for the second issue. Fran Lebowitz is our cover. She's the one who said the thing about feminism, is our cover model for the third issue. And here's a quick little tool through the third issue. Tour. Tool? End. Okay, now the pots and pans. I'm going to go through this really fast. Pots and pans, who would have thought? They are, the company was named because of Judith Jones, a food writer, and Great Jones Street in New York. We did the identity. It was meant to feel like an old school cookbook, and a little quirky and a little like New York Magazine. We wrote the tagline, ready to wear. And this is the logo. This is the monogram. This is the illustrations that we had commissioned for it, so that we had all different kinds of styles. This is what the pots and pans look like. They're beautiful. This is all the stuff on the pots and pans. This is the packaging. The idea was that the packaging, when you got the whole set, felt like a toy that a kid could play with. So it has an oven, so it's, like, you know, cute. Here's all the swag we did for them and the bag, and we had this idea to do magnets. Not that that's a brilliant, like, out-of-the-box thing to do for a company about kitchenware. We also work with them on the photography style for the brand, which is very eclectic, and all their social media and website. I'll just show you my favorite thing about the website. Boop, that. When you scroll over the pots and pans, the lids lift. And that's Great Jones. Anyway, because of Saturday Night Live and Leafs by Snoop and Pentagram, we got a call simultaneous to all of this other work. Certainly, you know, right around the time we were starting the bongs for, no, maybe a little earlier, but anyway, whatever. These two women called me. They had an organization called Film Independent, which is kind of like a not-for-profit organization for independent filmmakers, where you can, like, find other independent filmmakers and they help you. They also put on the Spirit Awards and the LA Film Festival. And so this is all happening at the same time. And remember those guys, Harry and Eli? This is just a little taste of what, like, when you're working, when you're, like, driven and you're working all the time, what your kids are thinking. So at school, Harry was asked to do a drawing of home and what it was. And this is what he wrote. This is just me and Eli. In my family, there's Harry and Eli, no one else. We are alone. Why they didn't call child services, I don't know. But, like, that's because Paul's a workaholic and I am doing, like, I'm juggling all these things. Heartbreaking. Anyway, Film Independent, two women called us. They asked us to do this identity. They'd seen Saturday Night Live and they knew Pentagram, and would we do the identity for their organization? They said, it needs a little fix. And we're like, no, it needs a big fix. So we looked at filmmaking and the history of film, and we sort of noticed that from The Shining, Stanley Kubrick to Godard, people always did this little thing with the lowercase i's, and so we thought, oh, maybe that's a good thing. But we wanted to do something clean and quirky. We also decided that their name wasn't too long, just their logo. So this is what it became. So we had sort of created a system for them, and we sort of worked with them on the copy. I Am Film Independent was a campaign that they did. And one of the things they do is the Spirit Awards, which is the anti-Oscars. It's the day before the Oscars. It's incredibly diverse. It's all cool movies. It's awesome. It's more of a party. It's on a beach in Santa Monica. And they said to us, this is another one of those opportunity moments, they said to us, oh, we hired a student to do this stuff for us for the show. We're having a little trouble. Could you just look at it and see what you think? Or no, they were doing it in-house. And before I even looked at it, I said, what if we just did it for you? Like, just let us do the whole thing. And they were like, we don't have any money. And I said, I don't care. That's the other beauty of Pentagram. It's totally a Robin Hood situation. You know, Michael Bayrou does the MasterCard logo and makes a lot of money, and I can, and because of that, I can do the Spirit Awards just for the cost of production. And Pentagram is designed that way so that we can all do good work. It's not about making money. It's never been about making money. Any hoodles, I don't know why I said that. They had also been doing this like scrappy comedy club brick wall thing for the Spirit Awards, and we were like, no, let's do something clean and cool. And the Spirit Award color was blue, and the Film Independent color was red, so we started doing this sort of like vibrate-y thing. And this is a little smattering of what we did. This is like the, you know, when you're walking on stage, the titles of like, you know what it is. Here it is. So we loved doing this, and it became a thing that we started doing every year for them. The next year, we did something. We wanted to do something a little bit fluid, a little bit curvy, a little bit different. I really should be looking here so that I can see you guys. But the funny thing is, we went in. So that's a custom font. It's called Font Independent, which is one of the other good things about designing a font is you get to name them. For that year, we decided to do a light version of it, and we had worked with Grilli Type to design the first one, and we just went ahead and made that other one ourselves because we were in a hurry and we didn't think about it. And then Grilli Type called us, and we're like, dudes, you can't do that. That's our font. And we were like, oh, shit. So fortunately, it was just an accident. Fortunately, they were really nice about it. We paid them retroactively, and we're all still friends. Anyway, I'm going to, so that was the last year, got it. That was the last year, and this past year is happening this Saturday. So I'm leaving here to go there, because I have to spend a day in the tent beforehand, checking all, I still like love like the, you know, getting my hands dirty, even though my team is awesome and they don't really need me, but I'm gonna go fly out there and work on the, you know, sound check and all of that. But I thought that I would show you the rough, like what we presented to them to get them to approve the idea, which will now air on Saturday. Here it is. Every lower third, we make every like freeze frame when they're introducing the, you know, showing the work, like all of it. Okay, you can turn it back up. I didn't think about is Film Independent is run by, like any organization that does that, is by run by people who give back. Like you go, you're part of Film Independent, then you go on and you have your career and you become more successful and then you join the board. So what I didn't think about is the two women who called me to start the project were a woman named Mary Sweeney, who is a famous editor. She used to be married to David Lynch, which is weird in and of itself. I mean, not weird, Mary's great. and a woman named Sue, and she's also a famous editor. She's won an Academy Award for editing. And then the other woman was a woman named Sue Kroll, who we got along really well. She loved what we did. And she was the head of marketing at Warner Brothers. This never crossed my mind. And so one day she called me, oops, I went too fast. One day she called me and said, I need a favor. We're trying to work on titles for a film. It's a new film. No one's been able to crack it. Would you, I love the way you think. Would you take a crack at it? And I just said, sure. And she said, oh, it's called Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them. It's sort of the prequel to Harry Potter. And I was like, holy crap, yes. Because we're nerds and, you know, J.K. Rowling and Harry Potter. Anyway, so I always say that research is our superpower. So we went in and we looked at what the beasts had been like for Harry Potter, because they were still designing them as we were doing this. And we also knew that it would take place in New York in the 20s. And so we did a lot of research about that. And then we went crazy and did a whole mess of logos for them. These are half of them, which normally we don't do. But we were just like, yeah, okay, pick one, please. And they ended up picking one, and this is how it looked in, when I saw it in the trailer, I was just like, what the? Makes me laugh every time.
Mr. Scamander.
We also designed a monogram for social media for them and a typeface. The typeface had two versions, a hairy one and a non-hairy one, so that you could do things like this or this. It's called Fantastic Beast. And then also these, because it's such a global brand, they had to localize the identity. And then I'm just showing this. This was Crime of Grindelwald. We also did that. Deathly Hallows is hidden in the logo, but I'm showing you this for one reason. So there it is, hidden in the logo. Great. But the beautiful thing about it, my favorite thing about it, is we got to design another typeface. Again, I didn't think I would ever be like designing typefaces. And when I say I mean we. Really, seriously, I mean we, because I, you know, couldn't do this without my wonderful team. Anyway, the typeface is called Crime's New Roman. worth everything for that. Anyway, because of Fantastic Beasts, we did so well that Sue said, you have to design the DC logo. I know. I'm going to go like a little tiny bit over. I'm almost done, believe it or not. Anyway, this is what the DC logo looked like when they came to us. And they were like, it kind of sucks. It feels really corporate. Nobody wants to put it on a t-shirt. And comic book people really want things they can put on t-shirts. It doesn't read well. And so we looked at the history of DC logos. Now, I'm going to guess that all of you are like, that's the best one. It's designed by Milton Glaser, and it's amazing. And I mean, every generation likes the one that was theirs. So also, DC has Marvel envy. And Marvel is a red square, so we decided that DC should be a blue circle, which Milton Glaser had already figured out. But for a myriad of reasons, which people who crap all over the things you do on the internet don't understand, we couldn't just, because my first thought was, let's just take that logo, give it 7 stars for the Justice League, and move on. But we couldn't. For legal reasons, we just had to do something different. So we did this. The idea was that it's really simple and really clean and kind of like feels like the logos had been. And so when they announced it, you know, this, and also always pentagram, that, like, it's just like Saturday Night Live. Like, pentagram sucks now. I would expect more from them. How many millions of dollars did they get paid to do this crap? That's someone's drawing of what we did. And the truth of the matter is, everybody hates things. They hate change. But my response to this is, give it a minute. Just give it a minute. And the other thing that I love about this logo is it's not what it seems. It has its own secret identity. We looked at it and we tried to bring a little something from every identity into it. Superman, like even Batman, his wings, his ears, his curves, and then all DC logos have a ring around them. So it feels like it belongs in the family. That was the thing to me. And the other thing was, it was meant to be a sponge. You were meant to be able to do whatever you want with it. And when DC started really doing that, I'm so confused by this two-slide thing. There it is on a t-shirt, first of all. There it is on swag and consumer products and billboards. And when DC started doing this, all of a sudden, it's actually really, like, so that minute passed and people, like, accepted it. So remember that when you're doing anything new, as people don't like change, but eventually they get used to it. And this is my favorite. DC did this, and it is awesome. So you can do anything with this logo. Anyway, because of DC and Fantastic Beasts, J.K. Rowling and her team said, these are the people we would like to redesign our umbrella brand. It's the Wizarding World. We don't want W's. We want something that really represents her. And this looked too much like the World Wide Web, so we looked at the things that make sense, that mean something to J.K. Rowling. She's the person who brought reading back to kids and grown-ups alike. The wands are the lightsabers of Harry Potter and Fantastic Beasts, so they're really important. And the idea of magicalness and bright light and sunshine, so... we made a logo that's a sun, book, wand combo. There it is. And the typeface is made up of things from Harry Potter and things from Fantastic Beasts, and it's called Harry Beast. And this one has its own color. Also, I never thought I'd be a person who did like golden chiseled type. Like I'm kind of a like clean minimalist person, but I always think that the work that you do should look more like your client than it should look like you. What should come through in the work that you do is that your imagination, your heart, your soul, the ideas, the thinking, that's what makes it yours, is what you bring to it. And when I work with a team, every team brings something different to the work, and that comes through. So I love this type. I love that it looks like this, because it feels right for them, and it's smart, and it's good, and it tells the story in the right way. Here's Harry Beast. So that is really important to, I think it's something that we should all believe. And then they made this. I didn't have to make this, they made this. They made that based on that little like boop, boop, boop thing we did to present the logo. So, and then they paid us for the idea, which was great. Anyway, working on, they're like, now we're like, Warner Brothers feels comfortable with us. And so the last thing that I'm gonna show is they, because of all of this work that we had done, they came to us and asked if we would want, if we would design the logo for Ready Player One. Ready Player One is a book that I loved. Anybody read the book? Awesome, awesome book. Do you know there's an Easter egg hidden in the book that if you found the Easter egg that was hidden in the book, you won, what's the car? I'm like, no, not a Tesla, a DeLorean. You won a DeLorean, and someone won it, an actual DeLorean. Anyway, so for Ready Player One, we did, it all takes place in the future, but it's a future where the guy who created the future, who created the world that they all live in, is obsessed with the 80s, which is a really brilliant marketing thing, because it's about the future, but everyone feels like they understand it because it's the 80s. So anyway, we did a ton of research of things that happened during, we looked for every like 80s reference in the book, this is part of it. And we also looked at typography that we thought represented it, which is, this is a typeface by Vim Crowell, but was too illegible for them. Oops, did I miss? Hold on. We also looked at a lot of fan art. Oh, it's gone. Anyway, we looked at a lot of fan art because there are a lot of fans of Ready Player One. Anyway, in the end, we ended up doing a logo that was like a combination of super, you know, like the idea of super future and Vim Crowell's typeface, but customized so that it read a little better because it's a movie, and also was sort of related to 80s video game style. And then, of course, we drew, you know, we drew it in like super 80s chrome type thing. But the beauty of this logo to me and also to Mr. Spielberg, not that I ever met him, don't want it to make it seem like I'm like in there with Steven Spielberg, because graphic design, not a particular, this like probably seems kind of glamorous, but it's really not. It's just a lot of hard work, and you don't get to meet Steven Spielberg. But what we did do is hide an Easter egg in the logo. And it was great when it was, because the book is full of like, the quest of the book is to find all these hidden Easter eggs in a virtual reality world that everyone on dystopian Earth lives in. So, nice. So we hid the Easter egg in the logo. And it was great on the day they released it, watching people sort of find it online. Again, it was about the idea, not necessarily the way it looks, though I love the way it looks. We also had this idea when we were presenting that they should do an ad campaign where they just took famous movies from the period and redesigned it so that it, you know, was Ready Player One, but looked like The Shining or Iron Giant. And they did it. Again, we didn't have to, which is a relief. But they actually made all these things and put them up, and I love that we can make that you can, you know, you could have a good idea and someone actually listens. That doesn't always happen, especially with a big corporation like Warner Brothers, which is actually, like Pentagram, run by a bunch of people who are really human and really smart and really passionate about what they do. They're not this corporate overlord. They're thinking people who are actually really nice to work with. Not assholes, never screaming in my face. And then this is the little film that they used to announce the logo. I'll tell you why it makes me so happy. Besides Queen. The whole thing was, you're inside the logo the whole time. That's like a graphic designer's dream right there. Anyway, that is the last thing that I'm going to show. But I also want to say, all of this work was done, as I kept saying, by a team of people, certainly not me alone. And sometimes I'm a big fan of the best idea wins, not my idea. And what people bring, like I said, different teams bring different things to people, and that's part of the beauty of working with other people. That's what's great about it. And everyone feels like they own the idea and they own the project. That's my dream. So none of this would have happened without the team, including making this chart. I did a little of it. And these are their names. Take a moment to read them. They are really talented people who you will probably hear about in not too long when they strike out on their own. Anyway, that's everyone. That's me. Thank you.